and a very, very, very cool guest that we have lined up for you guys today, Anja Fenter. So this is quite Anja's an amazing individual. So after studying for 4 years at Stelis in visual communication and also a master's in media studies at UCT and a further 5 at UCT doing a PhD, Anja, the self-proclaimed astronaut, has had an amazing journey. And this is just the short version, guys. So I'm going to give you a quick snippet. She's been a visiting lecturer at both Red and Yellow and the Creative Academy, and taught a qualitative methods course for postgrads in social sciences at UCT. She's also worked with some really cool blue chip clients, which some of you will obviously or may know of: Apple Music, Nike, Nedbank, Heineken, Mr. Price, just to name a few. So she's no stranger to the grind and the hustle. Super admirable individual, which I would love to cut my little talk short and invite to the microphone, or should I say to the screen share. Anja Fenter, please take it away.
Thank you for the brilliant introduction. I there's not that much more I can say after that. My name is Dr. Anja Fenter. I also go by Nana Fenter. And I want to talk a bit around this topic of procrastinate, which when Saskia reached out to me and gave me the sort of the themes for the next 3 months, I was like, no, that seems very topical in my life right now, because I've been wanting to do a talk on how I handle procrastination for a while. So like Daniel said, I see myself as an astronaut, which I know is not a real thing, but it gets a little bit frustrating when people are like, you know, the illustrator or the, you know, whatever, I'm sort of not in a traditional creative paradigm. I don't see myself as just an artist or illustrator or a designer or a writer, researcher, academic, teacher, student, entrepreneur, blah, blah, blah. I'm all of those things kind of at once, and I see them all as being sort of holistically integrated. And I think of myself, and this is where the astronaut thing comes from, as sort of exploring the creative universe through a variety of practices and disciplines. And just to give you an example of sort of my portfolio highlights from the past year. So I'm currently a postdoctoral fellow at the Cape Peninsula University of Technology, which has been really great to be back after sort of 3-4 years being out of academia, getting back into a sort of a research community and being able to do my work, but with the sort of research angle and being able to report on it, measure things, work with students, that kind of thing. So I identified this organization called Food Flow and started this campaign to try and raise money for their cause. I then started to measure for research, and we're in the sort of the 8th iterative cycle of this kind of merch project, exploring how kind of merch in the field of fashion communication can be a kind of form of symbolic innovation that can lead to sort of crisis communication, can build compassionate communities, can kind of get people to band together for a cause. And so there have been a few variations of this kind of work. This was my sort of Jurassic Patriarchy merch, where all of the proceeds were going to Rape Crisis. Those are sort of my merchy / academic projects. Then I also did a collaboration with Ubekuter Jewelers on a project called Talisman, also inspired by COVID. As I was reading up about sort of cures for the bubonic plague back in the day, I was sort of very amused when the idea of a talisman came up, that medical practitioners would go to these really ill people and kind of put something around their neck and be like, you know, that's going to sort out this pandemic. But after a lot of research on the sort of significance of talismans and how to imbue them with different meanings, I pitched this project to the jewelers, and yeah, we created this really beautiful piece together. Just before lockdown, I also worked on this campaign for Netflix for the launch of Queen Sono. These were installed as these giant murals all over South Africa, but unfortunately due to COVID, we never really got to see them activated in the spaces with people taking photos in front of them. Then book cover design. This is from a feature in the Mail and Guardian. I've also done a few lectures on book cover design, which I'm really passionate about. So yeah, that's one thing. Apple Music. This was probably one of my sort of most high profile jobs ever, although I'm not allowed to post this to my portfolio because they have all of the rights. I don't own it. But yeah, that was a really great project to work on. I've been working on a YA sci-fi novel called Avivale, which I've just completed the first draft and I'm busy with a few rewrites. On the left-hand side is an illustration that I created for the Journal of Cultural Studies, who invited me to do the cover for one of their issues mid-2021. That's all about the practice of futuring, or sort of imagining different futures. And I wrote a rationale for them about how I think sci-fi is, you know, this sort of forerunner of imagining how things could be different in the future. Then this was also one of my favorite projects that's sort of ongoing. I've been collaborating with former DC editor-in-chief, Shelley Bond, on her memoirs. And I've been drawing comics for her for this soon to be kickstarted. So keep your eyes peeled. And then lastly, my sort of greatest achievement of the year is my first solo fine art exhibition titled Monsters at the Cape of Good Hope. But yeah, I'll put links and everything right in at the end. So yeah, that's sort of my rundown of the year. And whenever I've done these kinds of presentations, whenever I've done these kinds of presentations at like schools or universities or whatever, people always ask me, you know, where do you find the time? You switch between so many different things. And despite the recurrence, it always takes me aback because I really do consider myself to be a master procrastinator. Like when I was writing this talk, I had spent about 4 hours sort of TikToking between my email inbox and then Facebook and Twitter and LinkedIn and Instagram and WhatsApp and TikTok. And sort of moments before lunch, I was suddenly like, okay, the day is passing me by. I need to actually sit down and write something and put this together. But there is always a message or a notification or a timeline to scroll or a thing around the house that needs to be done, especially as we're all working from home now. But when it comes to procrastination, I've sort of learned the fundamental thing that I like to say disarms the dawdle, which is that the sort of acceptance that it will happen, you will procrastinate, and that there's absolutely no reason to have to feel bad about it. And so starting from the basics, why do we procrastinate? And this is sort of what I've put together from a bunch of different articles that I found on the internet and things that I've come to know sort of intuitively. But I would say these are the top five reasons why we procrastinate. The first is that when a task is intimidating, we avoid it for as long as possible. We just, you know, it's like one day we'll be good enough to do it, but right now we're just a bit uncertain. Secondly, when we have too much to do, like all of these endless tasks that pile up, we don't know exactly where to begin. Thirdly, we are afraid that the work we produce will be terrible, so why should we even try? And fourth, we don't like to do the thing. It's tedious, or it's difficult, it's boring, or it takes long. And yeah, and lastly, and I think this was written in the write-up for this talk, is this idea that we wait until the deadline gets close to kind of motivate us, to push us towards the deadline. So I know that there are millions on the internet, there are so many different brain hacks and suggestions for how you can avoid procrastinations, how-tos and what not to do and so on. But I'm not going to be prescriptive. I'm just going to tell you how I deal with procrastination in my life. So firstly, I'm going to address each of these points and the way that I think about them. Firstly, realize that some of the biggest things that you are going to do in your life will be challenging and new and difficult, and it's normal to be uncertain when starting something new. One of the things, and especially working with students, I've realized that kind of holds us back is that people don't budget for preparation time. And for most creative tasks, this is a really important part of the process, is research, familiarization. You can't just jump in and do the thing. For the sort of, where do we start? And I love this little gif of like, to start, press the any key. Where's the any key? But I always think of Desmond Tutu's famous quote, there's only one way to eat an elephant, one bite at a time. So you need to frame that elephant into the actual bite before starting a project. Third, you don't have the confidence to do it. And one of my favorite sort of Bibles for living a creative life is Julia Cameron's The Artist's Way. If you have not read this book, or at least attempted to read this book, I would highly recommend it. But she says, you know, in order to do something well, we must first be willing to do it terribly. And another aspect of this, also from Julia Cameron, is this idea that you cannot be creative you cannot draw from an empty well. So she sees creativity as this thing as you constantly put input in and then the creativity flows out. But if you have no reserves, you know, you're not gonna have that confidence. So it's very important to spend that time to do other things that inspire you. I've often found that when I procrastinate, it's because I've just purely run out of mojo. Then it's tedious or it's boring. We think of creative work as being creative and fun, but unfortunately, I would say about 60% of it's absolute slog work, the sort of levers and pulleys of our industry that require oiling and bureaucracy and dealing with like people. And unfortunately, you just sort of have to power through it sometimes. Then that idea of waiting until the deadline to motivate you, then don't try to do it until right before the deadline. Schedule it for that day before the deadline. Free yourself, do something else. When I feel like the procrastination monster hit me, I do the following. So this is my method. I create what I call a commander list. So you know how it's easier sometimes when someone else tells you what to do, whether that's a personal trainer or a parent or a teacher or a supervisor or a friend. So a commander list in my mind is sort of an externalization of everything you need to do that, you know, you can sort of then assign to your future self. And it is still kind of big procrastination energy because you don't have to do the thing right now. It's sort of the future you needs to worry about that. So yeah, this is how I do it. Firstly, write down everything that you have to do that you can think of ever. I usually give myself a time limit, whether that's 30 minutes or an hour, and I write down everything, whether that's getting the car serviced or making an appointment at a dentist, buying new art supplies, you know, whatever, everything, things that you want to do one day. You write everything down and you do a bit of a process of automatic writing where you just sort of anything that you can think of. And if once you've exhausted that, good, then you're done with that part of the list. Next, you do a bit of information architecture. You start working through it. You start categorizing stuff. I love this because I do this when I procrastinate because I'm not being unproductive, but I'm not actually doing the work. I'm planning doing the work, right? So you then take everything that you have to do. You break it up into sections. And I promise you, once I've done that, my anxiety is dissolved because it's all on paper now. Now I know what I have to do. And I know a lot of people would prefer to do this digitally and people do have systems. And probably everyone here who is in production is like silly creative. Of course you need to make lists. It's not like a new radical idea. But anyway, so I have my different sections there. And then what I do is I take each section and I write down this is like the part of breaking the elephant into the bites. I think of every single thing that I need to do to complete that task. And that includes the drive to the printers, that Zoom meeting, the email, and my personal favorite, and this goes back to point one of the procrastination, things that lead to procrastination, is research and familiarization. I love giving myself that sort of a 2-hour time slot to just muck about on the internet. Okay, and once you've done that, then assign a time value to each task. So some of them might take 2 days, other might take 5 minutes. Take what you estimate and times 1.5 or 2, you know, to give yourself some extra procrastination time. Just build it in there. Then, depending on your personal poison, and like I said, a lot of people prefer to do this digitally, you assign these tasks to a future you. So I do this in a two-pronged system. The first is I have a status board that's up above my desk. It's a whiteboard and I use post-its and cookies and stuff to kind of plan out different things. So typically I then rewrite everything from that reworked list into the system. I use post-it notes to either batch similar tasks or portions of a task or a single subtask that might take a little bit longer, but they kind of work as tickets for tasks that need to be done, right? Then I take what is on there and also make sure to note your deadlines, of course, because the creative world is not free of deadlines, and try and sort of reverse engineer from the deadline how you're going to complete the task towards where you are currently, right? I highly recommend doing this in pencil so that you can move things around. And seeing as you've generously given yourself time limits on doing these tasks, you can now kind of time block stuff into your diary, giving yourself mini deadlines. So those little like fires that motivate you. I try to limit big to-dos to two things a day. And there will of course be admin and answering emails and things like that, but try and do that in sort of dedicated times, preferably in the mornings when your brain's a bit sharper and you can kind of switch between different tasks quickly. So then, and I do this very often, I would have assigned everything that I need to do for a full week, but when the day comes, I really don't feel like that thing that's on my list for the day. Then do something else. So what I then do, because it's in pencil, I can rub it out, I look at my status board, I'm like, huh, I actually really want to go do this thing today. And then I just move it around. And yeah, I guess sort of procrastination, in my humble opinion, will be a constant. You will always have to live with procrastination, especially as a creative, because we seek sort of distraction and inspiration and novelty in all of our experiences. But try and use that to your advantage. Try and feed yourself those things that you feel like doing at that moment instead of like sitting on something that you really don't want to do in that moment. I absolutely love this quote by Elizabeth Gilbert, where she says, possessing a creative mind after all is something like having a border collie for a pet. It needs work or else it will cause you an outrageous amount of trouble. Give your mind a job to do or else it will find a job to do. And you might not like the job it invents, eating the couch, digging a hole through the living room floor, biting the mailman, etc. It has taken me years to learn this, but it does seem to be the case that if I'm not actively creating something, then I'm probably actively destroying something, myself, a relationship, or my own peace of mind. So yeah, that's my talk on procrastination and some tips and tricks from my own experiences. If you want to check out some of my other work, is my web address, my handle, my email address. And while I have you all here, I've been going through a bit of a personal crisis. My cat is missing. So if you live in Obs or Rosebank or Mowbray or Rondebosch, please keep an eye out for this guy. He's very special and we miss him loads. Cool, thank you.